Consider myself to be old. I said I am. But I find out a lot of times you just gotta go, you gotta go by yourself. Even well-meaning people will send you on by yourself. But you have to do it. We've been left here for a reason to proclaim the gospel. And we have to go. We have to go by ourselves. Just two things in life I know when you actually go through. God is always with you. But when you're born, you come in the world by yourself. And when you die, you go out of the world by yourself, physically. But God is always there with you for the transition through it all. Listen, I'll go if I have to go. I'm gonna
Somebody said back in the day, well, that happened to me the last 48 hours. Tested on every side. Car breaking down. I used the plural term, car. One with no air and the other one just didn't want to work. If that weren't enough, then my air condition went kaboom at the house. I said, hey, here's something. And I said, Lord, the devil is alive. And then I had my sister, whom I was trying to assist her with something. I thought I was doing a pretty good job. Until she spoke up. She said, and I'm trying to assemble something for her with my saw, my drill. She said, don't you think you need to do this over here before you do bed over there? I looked up, I said, Lord, have mercy. And my response to her was, would you like to take the saw, the drill, and assemble this item together for yourself? No, I can't do that, she replied. I said, will you do me a favor, please? just be quiet. So I said all that to say this. Sometimes we have to be quiet and let the Lord speak to us. And sometimes we have to be humble and more patient and more of a sufferer for God to bless or bless us more openly. It's praying time now. And Deacon O.J. Leonard will come and lead us in our moments of meditations. Let us not forget to pray about the sick, the shut-in, incarcerated, those who are in leadership positions everywhere, because we stand in the need of prayer.
First, I want to say good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
God is good. Now it's another chance to be here. So may we pray. Again, Father, we just come in the most humblest way we know how, and Father. We say thank you, Lord, for you bless us to live a little while longer, that we are again to be here in the house of worship today, Heavenly Father. We thank you for so many, Heavenly Father, you have, that have been blessed to leave their wonderful homes and apartments and just to come and hear another word from heaven, because your word is forever. And Lord, we just can depend on your word. And Father, we said we thank you. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for you have been so good to us. You have been not to break the threads of our life, even to this moment in time. And Lord, we just say thank you. And we know that as we look out over the order, there's those who made their way out, maybe did not feel good, but that's their way to come on anyway. Then we know that there are those who are in nursing homes, and Lord, at the same time, they can't do anything but just smile. But Lord, however it is, help us to rejoice and continue to love one another, Heavenly Father. You have been our dwelling place down through the many years, and you have taken care of us. And we can still depend on you, Heavenly Father. Thank you for just keeping us, Lord. We ask you, Heavenly Father, now to bless the three families, wherever they may be, Heavenly Father. Bless them in the broken homes, Heavenly Father. Keep them, Heavenly Father, that we be kept in your name, O Heavenly Father. And Lord, forgive us any wrongdoing that we may have did, Heavenly Father, that we may stay on the righteous side and pray to thee from the rise of the sun to the going down of the sun. O Heavenly Father, we don't know about tomorrow, but we know that you hold the ball in your hand. So let's not take anything for granted, but to say, Lord, we love you with all our hearts, our mind, strength. And let us not forget, Heavenly Father, to love one another as we go from day to day, Lord. Bless us, Lord, and keep us. And those who have Heavenly Father, maybe who have not yet given their life to thee, we pray, Heavenly Father, today through your word that something will be said will cause people to come to give their life to thee before it's too late. We ask Heavenly Father to bless our beloved pastor and his family. Bless him as he comes to deliver the word to us today. Lord, that we will be receivers of your word, Heavenly Father. In our hearts, Lord, as we go out from this place, that we'll be able to touch the lives of others, and Father, as we go on our journey, Heavenly Father. For we know if we are to make it in, Heavenly Father, we will have to hear your word, and we have to let your word be a light for us to go by, that we may not go to the left or to the right, but that we may stay in that straight and narrow path. Keep us now, I pray, to Heavenly Father, and bless us. And when we are blessed to depart from this place today, Lord, that we may go back out, Lord, and let our light so shine that men may, and women may see our works and glorify thy name in heaven. Then when we must come to the end of our journey to Heavenly Father, and we shall call, and we will have to answer to Heavenly Father. We pray that through your grace and mercy, Lord, that I ask to be in your name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Yeah. Thank you, of course, for blessing our hearts. With Minister Lucas men, man, y'all should have sang another round. That's what he was saying. Right? It was a wonderful song. He just needed y'all to sing another round for him, because he's been struggling so much in the last 24 hours. And I tell you, when we think about God and all the things that we've gone through just within the last 24 hours, I tell you, he is worthy of all the praise. Ready for God's word today? Grab those Bibles, Lord, it's been just dealing with my heart. Let's go back to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Let's go down to that 13th verse, 1 Peter chapter 1. We started out on last Sunday and I'm talking about what must I do, or what does it mean to be saved? What must we do as Christians to be genuine? Having a genuine faith in the Lord. And we're going to continue on with that thought pattern in 1 Peter chapter 1. Go on down to that 13th verse. And while you're looking for that in your heads about, we ask you to please go on a word of prayer with me. Father, thank you. You're so awesome. And as Minister Lucas brought out the struggles that he's gone through, we realize they don't even compare what we could be going through.
Hallelujah.
Lord, in all our troubles and our trials, we know someone else is going through deeper struggles and trials, but we have consolation in knowing that you are faithful.
Hallelujah.
Lord, help us today to receive your word. Father, I pray that there's someone that has come here today that's not saved, that they will believe in their heart and confess with their mouth that Jesus Christ, your Son, is Lord, and Father, you have raised him from the dead. Thank you that it's by grace that we're saved, not of ourselves, it's the gift of God. Let them know, Lord, they cannot achieve these standards unless it's by the Holy Spirit working in their hearts. Now, Lord, I know my infirmities, my issues, my sins, and I ask you to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Therefore, Holy Spirit, I welcome you again. Would you please teach us and guide us and lead us into all truth? Make this word so plain, so easy to be understood that even a small child can be transformed to be like you. Father, would you be in my eyes and my seeing, my mouth and my speaking, my heart and my understanding. We thank you for your anointing. Lord, we need your anointing. Lord, speak to our hearts, our spirits, edify us, build us up, and if we're going wrong, correct us, Lord, that we may be pictures of who you are. We love you again. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 Peter chapter 1, starting at that 13th verse, Peter writes this on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, and be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Verse 14, 15, and 16, as obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust, as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. I want to speak from a subject, kind of a subtitle on learning what it is to be saved. Holiness is the Christian standard. Holiness is the Christian standard. I'm going to say that again. Holiness is the Christian standard. Very important as we have been studying this first chapter of Peter. Peter has made it expressly known he's an apostle of Jesus Christ, and he's speaking to the pilgrims of the dispersion. We identified on last time that he's probably coming out of Rome or Babylon. Time frame is AD 63, 64, talking to the Hebrew Christians, but also those who have been added under that Gentile family outside of the Hebrews. Very important, Peter was the lead of the disciples. He was the one when Christ walked with them that 3 years of ministry that would speak up. He was also the one that denied Christ 3 times and was humiliated in a sense. But when Christ rose from the dead, he was encouraged to feed the sheep. So much, I didn't say this on last Sunday, but it's believed in AD 68 that Peter would be crucified or was crucified upside down because he loved the Lord so much. He said, I don't want to be crucified right side up because that's the way Jesus was. Turn me upside down. There's some other parts of the extracurricular text that says that when Peter's wife died, he said these words, very faithful words. He said, die well, woman. In essence, she was under persecution, and Christians were dying for their faith. So this is very serious what Peter is talking about. On last time, that verse 7, just going back through it again, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. What does it mean to be saved? It means that we have been changed so much because God is taking us through the fire, and we have genuine faith. We have faith that is not just on Sunday. Thank you for coming out here today. And this is kind of evangelism. We're reaching out to those who are saved and not saved, because everyone in here is possibly not saved. But we are speaking to those who have genuine faith that know that they've been changed. He talked about in whom that we have not seen. We have not seen Christ, but we see him. When we see him, we know that we're going to be like him. And then going into that 9th verse that we stopped on the last time, it says, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. We identified on last time that we're working out our salvation with fear and trembling. No one in here can say that they have arrived. There are a lot of Christians that think that they're all that and a bag of chips just because they don't cuss as much as someone else. We have not arrived. We have a body sometimes that comes and feels like that they don't have to grow in the Lord. But if you keep reading these 66 books, you will find something that's not at the standard that the Lord would have you to be at. Holiness is the Christian standard. Verse 10, as we pick up today, of this salvation, the prophets have inquired and searched carefully who prophesied of the grace that would come to you. Holiness, this Christian standard. Peter goes back to the fact he builds his argument that salvation is through Jesus Christ, because he said the prophets of the Old Testament, they began to search carefully to see when the Christ or the Messiah would come. If you look back in our Sunday school lesson, Micah was looking for that Messiah. Jeremiah was looking for Messiah, that weeping prophet. Isaiah, known as that eagle eye, was looking for that Jesus Christ Messiah. Amos, the one with the plumb line, he was looking for the Christ. And they searched the scriptures and inquired very carefully and spoke good or prophesied that the grace is coming. Now, this is very important. I believe that sometimes we take our salvation for granted, but it took a whole bunch to save you if you saved today. Yes, there should have been some big amen in here. I know, you're looking around, you're like, man, these some nice looking folks, and they look like they got it all together, but we got some jacked up people that are in the house of the Lord today, and you don't know the corners that they used to stand on. You don't know the relationships that they were involved in. You don't know the sexuality that had messed up their mind, but by the grace and mercy of God, anybody say amen? It took a lot to save us. We don't want to take that for granted. Holiness is the Christian standard. Who prophesied of that grace would come to you. Verse 11, searching what? Or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ who was in them was indicating when he testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. Peter looks back the prophets come forth, Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, just a portion, that whole chapter. Surely he would bear our griefs and carry our pains, yet we did esteem him stricken of God and afflicted, but he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of peace was upon him, and with his stripes we healed. Peter said they prophesied. Isaiah looked and saw this before it even happened. Therefore, when Christ hung on that cross, he took our sins. He took the sins of the world. And it says the Spirit of Christ was in them, indicating that testified beforehand of the sufferings of Christ. To understand what holiness is about and that it's a Christian standard, you first must realize what sin is. You got to know that sin is a stench in God's nostril. You got to know everything that you do that's not pleasing to God causes sadness in his heart. We're living in our society that the standards of sin are changing. People are saying that sin is not sin, that it's actually good, and that's where the issues come. But most important, we see that Christians sometimes are getting confused what sin is all about. We're getting confused because we forgot. If you have been saved, you know when Christ came on the inside of you, he began to try some of your old ways. Some of you know when you got saved, you were still able to do some of that stuff. But the more you walk with him, the higher standard he called. Why? Because you are a Christian and holiness is the Christian standard.
Amen.
Sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. This is very important. By his sacrificial death on the cross, it enables me to live like God.
Amen.
This is important because some people just want to look to the cross and they say, man, that's wonderful. We can shout about what Jesus has done. But the enabling factor of the cross empowers me to live more like him. Now, I hear the question you're saying, Pastor, but don't all of us struggle with sin? Yes, we do. We all struggle with sin, but the standard for the Christian is that I want to be more like him. The standard of the Christian is, Lord, help me to be more like him. We all have our struggles, but we don't celebrate our struggles. Amen. We don't celebrate our sins, but we take it to the Lord and say, Lord, change me. Look at this. He proves that. Verse 12. He said, to them it was revealed that not to themselves, but to us, they were ministering the things which now have been reported to you through those who have preached the good news or the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Things which angels desire to look into. Holiness is the Christian standard. What we have as being saved is so awesome, angels want to peek at it. No, let me explain. This is just a portion of it. The angels have a hard time understanding how God could use such messed up folks. Now, this is from the angels' perspective. I'm not an angel, but when I read the scriptures, the angels were created for one purpose. That was to praise God. Now, we know that a third of the angels, they fail because they get out of their purpose and they follow the devil. Now, they're called demons. But the angels are there. Their whole purpose, when you read Revelation, is to give praise to the Lord and do that which God has told them. That is their whole purpose. And so they struggle with the fact, God, how can you use people that are so messed up in their mind? How can you use folks that have been contrary to you and by your grace and mercy change them and lift them up higher than we are? It's an amazing thing because when you understand your sin and you understand that by the cross I'm saved and you understand that how in the world can God change me from the inside out? That's where we see that word. The Holy Spirit is the factor that takes us to that holiness standard. Look at this, reported to you through those who have preached, through those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Things which angels, they desire to look in. They're looking at us because every day we walk with the Lord, it gets sweeter and sweeter. Yeah, they're looking at Deacon Kelly, Johnny Kelly. They don't see his deacon. They're looking and saying, okay, let's see how much God is going to change him today. They're amazing because since they were created in that righteousness spirit, they're looking at us. God, they're amazed. How can God work from the inside out?
How can God take something that was so messed up and torn and mend it back together again? You know what? In essence, the angels are rooting for us because it shows the power and the glory of the Lord. It shows that it's no longer dependent on ourselves, but what the goodness of the Lord is working on the inside of us. Holiness is the Christian standard. He says, since we understand this is coming together, what we have is salvation is so awesome that the angels are looking into it. Verse 13, he says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. He's talking to that dispersion that church is actually going through. They're being persecuted because Christ has changed their heart so much. They are coming out of the world. They're coming out of those people that are doing all kinds of lust, all kinds of sins, but they're being changed. They're being changed so much that their former friends are saying, what's happening to you? You don't party with us like you used to. You don't like the things that we like. You used to hang out with us all night long, but now you getting that Christian stuff in your mind and you're not the person. We don't like you as much that we. Who do you think you are? Holier than thou? And they'll even come to you and they'll say, all have sinned and fallen short of the kingdom. Lord will still love you if you're in your sin life, but there are those who have been saved. No, something has changed on the inside of me. My taste has changed. Look at this scripture closer. He says, now since we've got this, now you got to gird up your loins of your mind. Now in the Greek, this is powerful. But what he's saying in the Greek is when they would gird up their clothing, they would have robes on. And in that robe, if you were getting ready to do some work, you would pull your robe up and you would tie it so your robe wouldn't get in the way. The robes would like drag the ground per se. But when you were getting ready to work, you tied that thing up and you began to focus on the work that was before you. And so what Peter is saying, as we look at salvation and what God has done, now we need to gird up, or the loins of our mind. We need to come focus on the fact that God has a calling in our lives, and we need to stop playing with the world. But we need to stop looking at the standards that the world has set, and we need to deal with the standard that God has set for us. We need to come to the point of understanding, God, what holiness do you want to blossom in my life? So we need to gird up the loins of our mind, but then we need to be sober. Now, this is important. Some of you seen some drunk folks. When folks are inebriated, they're drunk, they kind of do whatever they want to do, you know? Yeah. Now, some are social alcoholics, and they can be drunk, and you wouldn't know they were drunk. They talk better than they used to talk, and they come out, they're the life of the party, and they can go all that, but they're still not sober. Sober means the opposite of being inebriated. It means that we can see our surroundings, and we can understand what's going on. So he says this, that we've got to be ready to work in our mind, and we've got to be sober in our mind, looking around us and seeing what's going on. Isn't that indicative of the church as we think about it today? Many of us may sit, but we're not really seeing what's going on. But we're not seeing that the enemy is not just attacking those who are Gentiles of the world, but he's messing with the church. See, to be honest today, some of you got some issues with the world on the outside, but what you really need to look at is how you live. Bianca, she will come often to my middle child, Joy, and she'll say this. They heard this quote. She'll say, Joy, how you live? And Joy says, living large, 365. And I propose to you today, how are you living? You need to stop looking at everybody else. And you need to start looking at yourself. How are you living? And the fact is, are you a Christian? Because holiness is the Christian standard. Look at this. Understanding that soberness, rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you are saved, we start to blossom, as said before, in our understanding of the Christ and the Anointed One, and listen to this, and then he's coming back again. The fact is, we don't know when he's coming back, but these are the last days. I really believe that. I see too many prophetic things that are coming together, and I understand, even if Christ doesn't come back in our lifetime, we're going to see him. The scriptures are very clear. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess. And what will be your mantra when you fall before the Lord? Look at this again, verse 14. He gives us an understanding, a standard. He said, as obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance. Holiness is the Christian standard. I want to start from the backside of that scripture. Before you were saved, you did a lot of ignorant things. I'm going to say that again because some of you get it. Before you were saved, you did a lot of ignorant stuff. Some of y'all still paying for your ignorant stuff. Come on, so can you talk to me a little bit? Before you were saved, grandma told you it was wrong, but you weren't saved. And you still did stuff that would mess up your life. You did it willingly. It was an ignorance of a type. Now, after you were saved, you still did stupid stuff. But you started to understand the repercussions of it. When you were doing it, you were like, I'm going to get in trouble with this because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is the eternal life. But when Peter comes from the point, he said that you used to do stuff out of ignorance. Remember your former sins. Now, the problem is in the church, as we talked about, the holiness is the Christian standard. Are you really different from your former self? Or have you just put a dress and a suit on? Are you really different from your former self, or do you just come to church on Sunday? Are you really different from your former self, or have you just cut down on how many days you go to the nightclub? But if you are saved, a change has to take place. A thought pattern changes in your mind. And Peter pulls this out. He's talking about to those who are saved. He says, as obedient children. If you were moved into my house, there's standards that have been set. Very simple standards. We hold up the scriptures. We don't expect you to cuss in our house. We don't expect you to fight in our house. And even though we have some arguments from time to time, we don't expect that. And if you moved into my house and you said, you know what, I don't care, Pastor Woods, I'm staying in this house and I want to do it my way, guess what? You got to get out of my house. In order to be a Woods in my house, we are obedient to the rules that are set up by the daddy. I'm the daddy. Right? You can get mad all you want to. It's my house. Can I get some marbles in there? Amen. It's my house. So since it's my house, I can set the rule. If you don't like my house, move to your house. But in my house, holiness is the Christian standard. So if you want to move in my house and become a Woods, you got to follow the standard. And Peter is saying, as obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts. See, outside of my house, as I say, the world, you can conform yourself to whatever you want. But when you come into God's house, that's the symbol I'm making, there's a standard for Christians. Now, the fact is, we invite everybody. We open up the doors to everybody because our hope is that they will be saved by the grace of God. But when it comes to the Word of God, only Christians can hold up the standard. Look at this. I'm going to prove something to you. Holiness is the Christian standard. It says, as obedient children, verse 15, but as he who has called you is holy, you also be holy. It's in the book. I love the book. I really do, because people get all mad at me, but it's in the book. This is very important. Peter brings this out to those who are being persecuted and going through. They're dealing with all kinds of things. He said, you got to understand, to be a Christian means we go through, and it also means that a standard is in our lives. It does not matter what other folks think about us. It means that God has already written it in the book. Therefore, he's going to enable us to walk like him. Look at this. He says, but as he who has called you is holy, so who has called us? God has called us, the Father, through Jesus Christ. He's enabled us, given us the Holy Spirit. He says, because this has happened, you also be holy in all of your conduct. So God, you're saying to be a Christian means I'm supposed to be holy in everything. I think we need to examine the church that we call the church today and ask ourselves, who's really saved? It's disconcerting to me that we're caught up and there are battles that are going wrong, and I'm tired of fighting with folk that aren't saved. I'm going to put it out there. Can I be real to you today? If you a heathen, you're going to do heathen stuff. I ain't got to prove my point to you. If you're a heathen, if you love the devil, you're going to sleep with the devil, you're going to do what the devil wants you to do. And you know what? Since you're on that side, just do it real good. Do it real good. If you're going to be with the devil, be a good devil. Just go ahead and do all of that. But if you're saved, now we can talk. Because to be saved means you change. There's a holiness standard. I'm not talking about just how you dress per se. There's a movement called holiness. It's all dependent on how you look on the outside. But I'm talking about the holiness that changes you from the inside out. You also be holy in all of your conduct. As a Christian, God begins to examine us in every state.
Amen.
Everything that we do, God is working on the inside of us. You ever been in a movie theater? You're sitting there looking at the movie, and you used to get enjoyed. It's rated R. Got some good scenes in it. Some make-out scenes. You're sitting there, but when you get saved, something moves. When you get saved, you sit there and you start looking over, wondering if there's a preacher in the house. Why? Because you don't feel like you used to feel. I told this story. When we truly got saved in our life, and Bianca and I, we were walking in the Lord. One time I got upset. This is just one time. I got upset with her. She was doing what a woman would do, Cindy. She was just doing y'all. I love y'all, but she was doing y'all, and I was doing what a man would do. And I wanted to let her know I leave this house. I wear the pants. And she was just going on and on. And I said, Bianca, shut up. Bianca's not here today. She's taking me to camp today. This is just between you and me. I told her. I said, shut up. But because we're saved, this was a long time ago. Don't believe me. Because we're saved, she looked at me. See, you don't know Bianca before Jesus. Oh yes, you don't know her. She looked at Dudley, let me say that. But she looked at me. But because she's saved, she began to laugh. And I began to laugh because I realized that was outside the character of being saved. See, beforehand, before salvation now, it'd be on like Donkey Kong. It would be on. You know what I'm talking about. But before salvation, you didn't care. But when you've been saved, oh, there's a different standard on the inside. When you mean, it does not mean the temptations are not there, but it means that somebody is calling you to a higher level. Last verse. Peter now goes back to the Old Testament, solidifies this, Leviticus, that 11th chapter and 44th verse. He quotes it. He says, because it's written, be holy, for I am holy. Guys, what is he saying? This is very profound and very simple at the same time. He's saying, because God has already said, the standard is set. You can fight with it all you want to, but because it was written in Leviticus, not just Leviticus, but throughout the Old Testament, it's already been put there. You can try to change it if you want to, but the word has already been set, it's been established, and you got to deal with it.
Amen.
So if you got issues with sin today, please understand your solution is the word.
Amen.
Search the word. I don't have to fight with you about what sin is. It's already stated in the word of God. I don't have to. I don't have to pull you to a moralistic standard, because I understand as a Christian that's been saved, you begin to fall in love with the Lord. You want to be obedient children unto him. And now you begin to lift up the 66 books, and there's a change that happened in your life. I can understand this pulling this together, this section here, understanding what holiness is, the Christian standard. It's all of what Jesus Christ did in those 3.5 years. Remember, he started that full-blown ministry. He's healing the sick and he's raising the dead. He's delivering folks. Before Jesus, people didn't understand what it is to have the good news and to be set free. But when Jesus came, he began to speak to all those who were troubled. He would touch those who were untouchable and say, there's some good news. I'm going to do something for you that's going to change everything. Now you don't have to work within yourself to try to be holy. But if you just accept what I'm going to do for you, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. That's why he had to go to the cross of Calvary. That's why he had to take the nails in his hands and the nails in his feet, because I have to speak for myself. My sin was so great. It was so messed up that there needed to be a sacrifice. My sin had to be placed on someone that was better than me. Someone who had never sinned. That's my Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one on that cross of Calvary. He died on the cross of Calvary. That meant that my sins were buried with him. But what I'm so glad, on the third day, he got up with all power and all glory. That lets me know that there's hope for me today. Yes, I struggle with stuff that's in my life. But please understand, I'm not the man I used to be. Yes, there's some former lust that started to pop up every now and then. But because Jesus got up, I can tell the devil, don't you forget Acts chapter 2. Because when they got on one accord in the upper room, all of a sudden the Holy Ghost came on the inside. Anybody know about the Holy Ghost? The Holy Ghost just doesn't have me to jump and run around and fall down. Sometimes he can move like that. But the Holy Ghost moves on Monday. It moves on Tuesday. But I wouldn't lose my mind. The Holy Ghost lets me know you have been changed right now. You're a different child right now. You're no longer a child of the devil, but you are a child of the God. But I know the Holy Ghost is on the inside of me. All of a sudden I can look at folks different, and I can say, it's by grace that you're saved, not of yourself. It's the gift of God. And I'll let them know, if you can only get Jesus on the inside, are there any real saved folks in the house? Oh, what a change comes over me. You don't know what God has done for me. But let me tell you a little bit. When I think about the goodness of you and all that he's done, you are not just a few folks. There's no God that's changed you. You ought to look at your neighbor and say, you don't know me before Christ. You don't know what I used to do. And I would cut up so bad, but now to Jesus. Oh, what a change. You think it is, but I know I've been changed on the inside because Jesus. Holiness. 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 Holiness is the Christian standard. How are you living? How are you living? Stop looking at everybody else. How are you living? What's going on in your apartment? What kind of stuff is in your refrigerator? And what's in the little squares in your basement? You know, some of you, you got stuff in the little squares. Oh, don't look at me like that. Holiness is the Christian standard. What are you going to do with it? You can't live this way without Christ. It's impossible. You can try to do it on yourselves for a little bit, but you're going to fail every time. Amen. But if you're really saved, I'm telling you, if you're really saved, if you've accepted Christ, things change. Things change. I don't know how quick it's going to be for you, but if you're really saved, standards of holiness are set. Not because you're trying, but you're obedient, and you know, my taste has changed. My taste has changed. Thank
Some of you are sensing that your taste is changing. You are the elect of God, the chosen. Things that you used to like, you don't like anymore. Celebrate that you're saved.
Amen.
Yeah.
But I speak to those who aren't saved. If your tastes haven't changed, you still enjoy those things of the world. Try Jesus.
Amen.
Try it. Right? I'm not telling you to leave the club. I'm not even telling you to leave your illicit lifestyle. But I'm telling you to get Jesus.
Amen.
Because when you get Jesus, he'll change.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can point my mirror. The cart before the horse. You get Jesus.
Amen.
You get Jesus, it's going to mess you up.
Amen.
I'm telling you, your whole life will change. You will get frustrated. Because your taste will change. Like, what happened? You got saved. Pastor, how can I know that I'm saved? So, scripture's real simple. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord over everything in your life. And you will be saved. I said, Pastor, I've done that. Well, listen to this other part. It's by grace that you're saved, not of yourself. It's a gift. What does that mean? One of my nephews had a birthday party. We gave him a gift. He actually asked for something that we didn't give him. Because what we gave him, we believed that it was going to be better for him. That he was going to have more fun with it. Well, I'm telling you, Jesus has a gift for you. Just receive it. Are you tired of struggling within yourself? Say, Christ, save me for real to the utmost. And watch the Holy Ghost change you. As we give an altar call today, our deacons will come forth. And we've got a young group, our Generation Bridge, 18 and up around those age. They've been praying. 18 and up, it's a tough, that middle group, because there's so many lust, temptations. But they've been praying for revival. So I'm going to ask them to come up, and they'll just be praying at the altar and seeking the Lord. We need a real change. We need people that love the Lord, not just on Sunday, but every day of the week. People that are willing to change their schedules to get more word of God and to pray with one another as they see the times changing. Remember, holiness is the Christian standard. The more of God's word you get, more change takes place in your heart. As they're here and they're praying, hearing the voice of the Lord, first call, listen to me, salvation. Don't be ashamed. Accept Jesus in your heart. Say, Pastor, I've done that. Why do I need to come forth? You come forth as an open confession. You're saying, God, it's me. It's me. It's me. It's me. It's me. If you're here today and you're ready to accept Jesus Christ, he's made you ready. It's by grace. Come on forth today. Say, I'm ready to make that walk. Someone would love to grab your hand and pray with you. Would you come forth today? Salvation. You say, I want to be real. I want to be real. I need the true Holy Spirit. Oh, God.